I want to thank everybody for coming out to make history tonight by electing Elizabeth May as the first Green Member of Parliament in Canada. So whether you've previously been a New Democrat, or a Liberal, or a Conservative for Conservation, it's time to get behind Elizabeth May for a fresh new voice, for a positive vision, for something very new and better for Canada. So you know, they say the definition of insanity is doing the same things over and over again while expecting different results each time. Well, the same goes for politics. If we only vote for the same old parties with the same old politics, we can't expect different results. The people of Saanich Gulf Islands are privileged to have a chance to really make a difference this time, a nationally significant difference that will resonate throughout Canadian and world history, to elect the first Green Member of Parliament here, Elizabeth May. Is Bill Devereaux. And he's come all the way from Pender Island to be with us. And Bill's a very well-known guy, famous guy. He's a founder of the BC Civil Liberties Association. He's worked as a lawyer, a journalist, a scriptwriter. He's the creator of the popular TV show Street Legal, and he's a first-rate author, including a new work of fiction, Snow Job, that involves a character seemingly similar to Elizabeth May. Here we have Bill Devereaux.
Well, in that book, my character wins an election in this constituency for the Green Party. It's a great predictor of what's going to happen on Monday. I met Elizabeth 17 years ago when I was organizing a writer's event, a fundraiser, to raise funds for the protesters at Chilliwack Sound who were being jailed. I made support from icons like Margaret Atwood and Pierre Burton, Farley Mowat and Bill Reid, and Lorna Crozier, she was there too. And our final speaker was Elizabeth May, as head of the Sierra Club at the time, and she was so eloquent, and so wise, and so refreshingly direct, that I said to myself, that woman ought to be in Parliament. And 5 nights from now, God willing, she will be there. My wife, Tekla, and I voted on Monday at the advanced poll at the Pender Island School, and afterwards we mingled outside, as small islanders do, talking about the election, about 10 of us. And it turned out everybody who'd voted were voting for Elizabeth May. It was a cross-section of the aisle. There were old-timers there who've been conservatives all their lives. And they admire Elizabeth for her directness and honesty, and so they're voting for her. They're tired of the same old scripted cant. Now, I've met longtime liberals over there who believe their leadership has cowardly backed away from environmental issues, and so they're voting for her. And Eddie Pierce, well, we were at a dinner on Easter weekend, big dinner at our Anglican minister's house, and everyone there was voting for Elizabeth except one guy, die-hard NDP. He voted NDP all his life. It's like a knee-jerk reaction. And he said, oh yeah, Elizabeth is far and away the best candidate in this constituency, and he can't stand Harper, but he has to be loyal to his party. He actually canvassed for me eons ago when I was a NDP candidate in Vancouver Centre. I said, Bob, free yourself. I did. It's not hard. You will find peace. And I think I won him over. And I'm here urging every one of you to do as I did, to try to sway at least one person, a friend or a neighbor, to break with the past. Get out there, talk it up, make history, and send this lovely woman to Ottawa. Yeah.
Our next speaker, moving along here, Bob Simpson is an independent provincial member of the Legislative Assembly for Cariboo North, and previously worked as a forest critic and Aboriginal relations critic for the NDP. He's known as an outspoken, principled, and visionary politician, in particular with the passion for climate change issues and environmental issues, and he's certainly one of my heroes. Here we have Bob Simpson.
Well, Ken just made my day. If I'm one of his heroes, I'm done. Because Ken knows that I have a lot of time for him. Whenever he promises a rally in the lawns of the legislature that will break the last record, he does it. Now, I told him I get more nervous when I get invitations from him to speak than I get anywhere else, because I know I'm going to speak to one of the largest crowds that I ever have to speak to. So, thank you for showing up. This is an event about making history, and as we all know, history is only made by those who show up. More importantly, history in this context is made by those who vote. And that's what I want to speak to for a few minutes, because I know I'll get yanked if I go on too long, as politicians are supposedly want to do. There's a Chinese proverb, cursed is the person that lives in interesting times. I've decided that we no longer live in interesting times, we live in dangerous times. We live in dangerous times on two fronts. One, our democracy is at risk. And I don't use that phrase lightly. We have traditional political parties that have held such sway over our democracy, over our parliamentary system, over our legislative systems for so long that all of them are in contempt of Parliament, not just one. And some of you who know my history know that I ended up getting kicked out of one of them for some tepid response to a speech that the leader gave, but the reality was I wasn't allowed to fight inside that party. I wasn't allowed to have an inside voice to try and make that party more democratic. And when I read Elizabeth's book, Losing Confidence, which I think should be a primary reader for everybody, I saw a person who gets it, having never been there. And so I'd like her to be there. Elizabeth and I have had an illicit electronic relationship up to this point. I tweeted her and emailed her about some of the work that she had done in Losing Confidence, and I said, this is brilliant, you're speaking to my pain as an insider, and I hope you get to go to Ottawa to change that, because I think her voice in Ottawa would be the person who says, the Emperor and the Empress have no clothes, it's got to change, we have to recapture our democracy. The second reason I think that Elizabeth needs to be in Ottawa is the second reason I think we live in dangerous times, and that's we're running out of time. We just don't have time to play this normative, silly bugger politics that goes on. I'm in my MLA duds. I just came from question period with the new leaders and the new caucuses and all of that fun stuff in BC. Well, it's the same old, same old. It's pure, crass politics, 24/7 electioneering, no governance whatsoever, and we don't have time for it anymore. So we need someone in Ottawa who's going to call everybody's bluff, who's going to talk about climate change, which is not being talked about in this federal election, who's going to talk about breaking our dependency on fossil fuels, which is not being talked about, although sustainable oil sands are. Anyway, we'll leave that one alone. We need someone in Ottawa, unencumbered by that perpetual electioneering, who will stand on the issues that go across generations, that make sure we deal with what needs to be dealt with now, and I believe Elizabeth will do that if we send her to Ottawa. So my challenge to you is, history will only be made if you replicate yourselves. I don't mean that in the way that you're all giggling about. You need to go out from here, and this is a phenomenal turnout, but you need to go out from here and you need to replicate yourself tenfold and a hundredfold over this coming weekend. And you need to not just nod your heads, you need to do it. Get on the phones, make a commitment to drive people, but make sure you replicate yourself so that on May 2nd, we send a true Democrat and a person who fundamentally gets that we've run out of time to get a progressive, sustainable society to Ottawa. Make it happen. Make history happen.
I just wanted to quickly mention something. The largest pre-election rally this campaign period was when Stephen Harper showed up on Saturday in Campbell River. It was reported 500 people showed up. This hangar here fills 1,200 people. We have broken the record. This is the largest pre-election rally in the past 2 years. So our next speaker is somebody who has really sent shockwaves through Saanich Gulf Islands. We have Fraser Smith. He's a prominent former Conservative and Reform Party activist who has become an ardent Elizabeth May supporter. He's a bigger fanatic than I am. And he previously served for 6 years on the National Executive of the Reform Party of Canada. He ran the Reform Party War Room for the 1993 election and was Preston Manning's wagon master for the 1997 federal election. He's currently an executive member of the Saanich Peninsula Chamber of Commerce. He's an honorary Paul Harris Fellow of the Sydney Rotary Club, and he's a Conservative for Conservation who supports Elizabeth May.
May and May. All these May and May signs are coming from Salt Spring. So it's time for the heavyweights now. 270 pounds. I was raised by my parents to be civil, to be polite to others, to be kind, respectful. And I'm guessing that all of you were raised the same way. I'm guessing that you're raising your kids the same way. And so what happens when we send somebody to Parliament? Doesn't it disgust you to watch the goings-on in our House of Parliament? The negative attack ads. My parents wouldn't watch it. They gave up finally. Just wouldn't watch it because there was something wrong. And there is definitely something wrong. Over 1,000 good Canadians, probably raised the same way as you and me, are running this week to represent their riding in Ottawa. And pretty soon we're going to see them in action in the House of Parliament. And what happens is the system co-opts them. These good people, the bulk of them are very good people, get down there and the system takes them over. And they're commanded to stand up and jeer, insult any speaker that wants to try to speak, degrade them, whatever it takes to prevent anybody from speaking in the House of Parliament. And it's the saddest of things, in my opinion. It's the only part of government that we actually get to see. It's the tip of a pyramid, and that pyramid is big, and underneath is where the graft occurs, the corruption occurs, the waste, the decisions to spend $9 billion on more prisons. That happens out of sight. Under the current circumstances, we do have the chance to watch them in action, and so, of course, they're co-opted. The leaders point them out. You will jeer today. There's jeerers, and they got assignments. These are the rubes. Some of them are not rubes. Gary Lunn is not a rube. I believe Gary when he says he's never done that. And there's others that don't either. And what happens is then they are marginalized by the people that run the party, the people in the back room. They have no traction. They sit there, they take it, and they come back to the writing and tell us how it's going to be. And so it's time to clean it up. And we have a chance in this writing to do that. When I used to go driving with my wife and the kids were fighting in the back seat, if they kept that up, we had an unwritten rule. We just pulled over, we looked straight ahead, we didn't have any words, we just waited. Finally, the kids realized they weren't going anywhere and they quit fighting. No words, we took off again. I probably only did it two or three times in my lifetime. And Elizabeth May has a plan to clean up the part that we can see as a beginning. The part we can see will be cleaned up, because when Elizabeth stands to speak the very first time, we'll all be watching. She will wait until the House quietens down. Well, it won't quieten down. You see, the rubes have got their job to do, and they'll heckle and they'll insult her. And finally, Elizabeth will sit down. And the Speaker, he has to stand up and defend the rules of the House, which are, as your parents taught you, you are to be civil in here. You're to speak kindly of others, etc., etc. He knows the rules. In the meantime, it's being abused. And finally, he has to call for order. And they'll calm down. Elizabeth will stand. They'll jeer again. They'll insult her. And she'll sit down again. And she'll do it as many times as it takes until finally the Speaker of the House gets it. There's people watching this on TV. All those people out there are watching this abomination that is question period. And finally, all of us across the country will start to demand that our politicians start to run that end of the business in a proper way, in a polite way. So, folks, who are you supporting here tonight? Who ran the Sierra Club for 17 years? Who is one of the 100 most influential women in the world? Who are you voting for? Who will be our MP on Monday? Louder! Louder! Go get him, Elizabeth!
Thanks.
Excellent. Moving along. We got to keep moving. We've got the next speaker is Vicky Husband. Everybody here will know Vicky Husband. She's the executive director of the Sierra Club of BC for so long and is one of the most best-known conservationists in Canada. She is a recipient of both the Order of BC and the Order of Canada and has worked closely with and has been best friends with Elizabeth May for many years. We have Vicky Husband.
I usually say things like good planets are hard to find. It's good planets and good countries are hard to find. So I'm not just here for Elizabeth and her daughter Victoria Kate and everybody here and people in Canada. I'm here for the country. The issue is Canada. The issue is democracy. That's why we're sending Elizabeth to Ottawa. That's why we're sending the secret weapon to Ottawa. That's what we need. I've watched Elizabeth work for so many years. You know, she's amazing. And I could talk about her integrity and her intelligence and her knowledge, but it's her humor and humanity, I think, is legendary. That's what really drives her. It's her caring for people and for the country. And that's what's going to change Ottawa. She can do it. If anybody can, we have this historic occasion, an opportunity to make a real difference in the Canadian political situation. And I've read Losing Confidence. It's great. I was there at South Moresby. I used to lobby in Ottawa when it made sense. It doesn't make sense anymore. We see Lund's Folly down the road. I drove under it tonight. There's $25 million of our dollars down the road. This is not what we want. I think tonight, what we're talking here, we're talking about the country. This is what we love, and we couldn't send a better winner to Ottawa than Elizabeth May. She, with all our support, will make such a difference. And that's up to all of us. And as Bob Simpson said and others said, it's up to us to get the vote out. Get everybody you know out to vote. That's what the Conservatives do. That's what we have to do to make it happen. That is how we make send Elizabeth to Ottawa, and that's the difference we as citizens here tonight can make. Keep the faith with Elizabeth. Send her to Ottawa. Thank you very much.
Great. Our next speaker here, we've got Bill Henderson. He's a musician, a singer, songwriter, and a sustainability advocate. He's best known from his role in the Canadian rock band Chilliwack, with numerous hits throughout the 1970s and 80s, and he currently lives on Salt Spring Island, where he spends his time making music and being an Elizabeth May fanatic. He has also written a song about Elizabeth May, which we're going to play here for you after he plays one of his hit songs, but he's going to speak as well. So here we have Bill Henderson.
Hello, everybody. It's incredible to be here tonight and see so many people here. This is really, really exciting. This is a momentous evening. This could be the beginning of a whole new thing. And I just want to say a little bit about how this is going to happen. We live in the most incredible place in the world. I've been on the road for many, many years. I've seen many places, and I'm always incredibly overjoyed to come back to the Sailor Sea. I was born here, I was raised here. It's an incredibly serene, beautiful, and abundant place. And I think that plays a role in all of this because it helps us to feel some serenity, to feel a little bit of the abundance and beauty, and to have a little perspective, and to be able to see what the world needs, maybe a little more than those who are not so fortunate. So we're in an incredible position to do something. And, you know, we're gonna put the very first Green Party seat in Parliament. It's a fantastic thing. It's a gift. It's a gift. This will be a gift from the West Coast to the rest of Canada. What a thing to do. Good for you. This is showing real leadership. All we have to do now is go out into our communities, into this, in this riding, and spread the word every day between now and Monday, and real change will happen. I just want to say also that, you know, music is a place that I was able to go to after feeling the beauty of this place when I was a young kid, just being with the sea. It just was a very, was wonderful. It was so wonderful. And as I went through puberty and got older, all of the buzz started to happen, right? And music was a place where I could go to reconnect with all of that. And then I could connect with people like yourselves and really enjoy and get high on the beauty of life itself. So this is a song about that, and it's about you and me. Actually, Elizabeth had told me a story a long time ago, and it got me thinking about writing a song for her. It evolved into this thing here, and I got the basic feel of it going, and then I thought, you know, we could put all kinds of old famous song lines on top of it. There's people in this writing who've written incredible songs, So Randy Bachman consented to come and sing a little bit of taking care of business and a little bit of, you know, she'll be taking care of business and you ain't seen nothing yet. And that's right. And Sherry Ulrich singing her famous song, "We're Ready." I know we're ready. And I sang about our girl, Elizabeth, as well. And so we're going to play you the tape. I'm going to kind of sing along with it. You can sing the chorus along with me, and I'll indicate it to you. And then we'll get to a section where there'll be some people, I think, these people over here sing the chorus, and the other people will sing the chant at the end. You'll see what it is. I'll start doing it. You join with me, okay? Let's do it.
That 700 to 800 people could come out here tonight to make history. And we've got a few more speakers yet before we get to our deputy leaders, George Laraque and Elizabeth May. Right now, we've got Des Kennedy. Des is one of the most influential personalities in the Canadian gardening scene. He's been nominated 3 times for the Stephen Leacock Memorial Medal for Humor. He's written 4 books of essays, 3 novels, scores of newspaper columns. He's also a well-loved radio and TV personality, especially known for his CBC appearances. And he's also been heavily involved in campaigns to save Strathcona Provincial Park and Clackwood Sound. So here we have the gardener, writer, humorist, and activist extraordinaire, Des Kennedy.
Thank you, thank you. It's a miracle they didn't have the Rolling Stones on before me. Well, you know, it's great to be here, of course, as everyone has said, and I think the two great moral imperatives that face us immediately at the moment are, first, to ensure that Stephen Harper never forms a government of any description ever again. And the second of those, as you well know, is that Elizabeth May takes her rightful position in the Parliament of Canada. Now, pondering these two great moral imperatives, I came upon the not entirely original metaphor of considering the previous several years under Harper and the Harperites as really representing the winter of our discontent. A long and dispiriting and gloomy and mean-spirited and selfish and egotistical and altogether disgusting spectacle that's made us the laughingstock of nations. Contrast that, of course, with everything that Elizabeth represents, that whole sense of nurturance and compassion that she so exemplifies, her inclusiveness and her tolerance and her, mostly to me, her astonishing joyfulness in oftentimes not very joyful circumstances. She's just a wellspring of joy. And the vision, I think, that of course is at the heart of all of this, certainly at the heart of her politics, is a love of the earth and a love of all living things. And so I'd like to give you just a very brief ode to the voices of spring. And most all of us living on islands are quite familiar with these great voices. By the middle of February, those of us who have overwintered on the forests of the Pacific Northwest are often a sodden and downcast lot. 4 months of more or less relentless rain have begun to take a psychic toll. All color seems leached from the landscape, and sunshine lingers only as a dimming memory. One's ground of being decomposes into a soggy primal ooze. A gray melancholy clings like mist to the spirit. An uncharacteristic morbidity seeps into the collective unconscious. Then, just as everything seems hopeless, the tree frogs begin to sing. For a night or two, there may be only a few brave individuals whose preliminary croakings go almost unnoticed. But soon their numbers swell, and their singing builds to a mighty crescendo, breaking over us like a tidal wave, a throaty tsunami of sound. This is not some mere haphazard croaking, some church basement chorus of frogs. This is a brilliant, night-shattering, mad opera of the universe. Massed together in their thousands, these lusty tenors, Pavarottis of the ponds, sing every night for love. From February through May, they croak and make love, and their wild rioting lifts us from our torpor and hurls us too into the luscious lasciviousness of spring. Thank you so much. I give you the springtime of Elizabeth May.
Nice. So now we've got Lorna Crozier. She's an esteemed and award-winning poet, writer, and editor who has authored 14 books of poetry, including Inventing the Hawk, which is the winner of the Governor General's Award, and edited numerous nonfiction books and anthologies. She presently teaches and serves as the chair of the writing department at the University of Victoria. Lorna.
rock band and then Des Kennedy, eh? I'm here to speak in support of my politician, Elizabeth May. And after decades of writing, I have never used those two words together before. My politician. Five years ago, the Spanish poet Federico Garcia Lorca could not have known that he was being prescient when he wrote one of his most famous opening lines in one of his most famous ballads, and please excuse my Spanish, Verde que te quiero verde, green, how much I want you green. For the sake of the country, for the sake of the planet, for the sake of what I value as a woman and an artist, for the sake of what I care for what the sake of what I know I've lost, and for my hope for the future. Verde, que te quiero, verde, green, how much I want you, green.
Now, Elizabeth just said, this must be the most intelligent political rally ever organized. Now, our next speaker is somebody that everybody here will know. It's Arthur Black. His voice is unmistakable voice on the radio and on the written page. He's well-known as an award-winning writer of numerous books and winner of the Stephen Leacock Memorial Medal for Humor. He hosted CBC Radio 1's Basic Black program from 1983 until 2002. And his recently released audio CD, Planet Salt Spring, features tales from his home of Salt Spring Island, BC. Here we have Arthur Black.
Ken's right, this is easily the most intelligent political rally ever held in the history of the world. I'm here to bring the tone down. My name is Arthur Black. I live on Salt Spring Island. That's like saying I'm from Korea. Because as in that other island kingdom, there is a Salt Spring North and a Salt Spring South. Salt Spring North has yuppies and yachts. Salt Spring South has hippies and yurts. There's a fair bit of cross-pollination. You can find rock stars in the North End and retired bankers in the South End. But that's Salt Spring, too. Nothing makes ABC connect the dots sense on that island. Aside from the fact that you can't take anything for granted on Salt Spring, you can't take anything for granted on Salt Spring. The guy that sorts your wine bottles at the recycling depot could be a Buddhist, could be a Bible belter, could be a full-dress goth or a polyester geezer. There is no congruency on Salt Spring. It's a prickly pear patch of contradictions and contentiousness. We agree on nothing, ever. Nobody ever said it better than Valdi, who defined Salt Spring as a difference of opinion surrounded by water. And yet, I think even Salt Springers would have to agree, that we have never seen so many daffodils on the island this late in the season. Now, I put it down to the long, cold spring, except that this latest bloom of daffodils has writing on the petals. You can see a few in here. They read May in May. May Day officially begins on May 1st. It occurs on May 1st. This year, for voters in Sandwich Gulf Islands, it comes one day later. May in May. It's short, it's sweet, and it's hard to confuse. And that's a good thing in politics. Because the incumbent Tory wouldn't even be running in this riding if 3,667 knuckleheads in the last election had not marked their ballot for the NDP candidate who had in fact withdrawn from the race. But that was then, and this is now. This time around, we have three worthy women and the incumbent running in this riding, but as we all know, the race here is really between two candidates, Tory Blue and Gaia Green. It's been said 1,000 times already, but it is as true as anything ever gets in this murky game of politics. Voters in Saanich Gulf Islands have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to actually change the way the game gets played. We not only have the best green candidate running in our backyard, we have the best candidate of any party in the whole blessed country running in our backyard. Plus, and I don't want to call it a perfect storm, a perfect orgasm maybe. A green victory here is a Tory defeat in Ottawa, and one less sock puppet singing in the Harper Choir. We've already seen how frightened the other party leaders are of Elizabeth May. Let's scare the crap out of them. Let's vote her in. May we? To steal a line from another successful political playbook, yes, we can.
Dauncey, one of the main pioneers of the whole sustainability and climate change movements in the Greater Victoria, Southern Vancouver Island region for a long time. Pretty much everybody has heard of Guy Dauncey speak in person at one time or another at a presentation. He's the editor of the EcoNews, author of many books, including the award-winning The Climate Challenge, 101 Solutions to Global Warming, and he's best known now as a speaker and activist for sustainable energy alternatives to fossil fuels. Here we have Guy Dauncey.
Wow. Are we ready to make history?
Yeah!
Do you want a Member of Parliament to represent you in Ottawa who has a passion for life and an equally passionate vision for a green, sustainable Earth?
Yeah!
Do you want a Member of Parliament who truly understands the climate crisis, who's written a whole book about it, and who's been to every one of the recent UN climate conferences, who knows the danger that it poses to our collective future, and who will be 100% committed to try to implement the best solutions?
Yeah!
Do you want a Member of Parliament who understands the word respect, and who will be totally committed to end the culture of bullying and aggression that has come to dominate Canada's parliamentary culture?
Yeah!
Do you want a Member of Parliament who knows how Ottawa works from hands-on experience, both inside and outside the system, and who knows how to get things done?
Yeah!
Do you want a Member of Parliament who understands the need to protect Canada's forests, who's even written a book about it called At the Cutting Edge, The Crisis in Canada's Forests?
Yes!
Do you want a Member of Parliament who's been an activist all her life, and who shared her knowledge and experience in her very personal hands-on book, How to Save the World in Your Spare Time?
Yes.
In that book she wrote, we have to do what we have to do. Miracles happen. The life force of the planet is very strong. Dandelions poke through sidewalks. We don't know enough to give up. We only know enough to know that we have to try to change the course of human events. Do you want a Member of Parliament who thinks this way?
Yes!
Do you want a Member of Parliament who lists as one of her most cherished moments dancing in the sand on a beach in Miami with Bella Abzug and delegates from the Women's World Congress while Leslie Gore sang, It's My Party?
Yes!
One of Elizabeth's favourite quotes is by Martin Luther King, who said, our lives begin to end the day when we become silent about things that matter. Do you want a Member of Parliament who thinks this way?
Yes!
Do you want a Member of Parliament who lives her life as a gift to the world, seeking fresh ways to make it meaningful every single day?
Yes!
Do
She wants a Member of Parliament who will be the voice for people who care about the future all across Canada, and who will be free to speak her mind. Yes. And you want this Member of Parliament to be our Member of Parliament? Yes. Do you want this Member of Parliament to be Elizabeth May, elected in the month of May? Yes. I rest my case.
So we've had a lot of high-profile speakers, some of the smartest and most competent people, and today we also have a real treat. We've got We've got Georges Laraque. He's a former NHL hockey star with the Montreal Canadiens and Edmonton Oilers. He's the deputy leader of the Green Party of Canada since last year, and he has been involved in promoting healthy lifestyles, a healthy planet, through advocacy for animal rights, disaster relief for Haiti, where his family is from, sport, fitness, healthy living, and a sustainable society. So here is the enforcer for Elizabeth May, Georges Laraque.
Hello, everybody. It's so nice to see all of you guys today. Such a great gathering because history is in the making. I'm so excited about this election because we're finally going to get our first MP. We've been waiting for this for so long. And this is not about any one of us in the Green Party. This is about Canada, about our future, because our future is at stake. As we all know, 41% of people don't vote because they're sick of politics, they're sick of lies. When we're finally going to get our first MP, things are going to change. People will trust us again. There's one thing that we do know, is that the other parties are scared of us. And that, they showed it to every single one of you in Canada by blocking Elizabeth to go to the debate. And what's crazy about that is that they all said that, of course, they support her to be in the debate. But if collectively they were able to change the day of a debate because of a hockey game, really? So if they really wanted to be there, she would have been there. But the question is, why don't they want Elizabeth to be there? That's because they don't want to face the real problem that is facing us in Canada. Global warming issues, women's issues, Aboriginals issues, homeless people's issue, and the war in Afghanistan. They don't want to face those real problems. We're ready to do so, but they don't want to. They want to stay away from that. In the national debate, they didn't talk about any one of those problems. So what did they do to get your votes? What's their tactics? And to spend millions in attack ads. In 2011, they're using a method that is not allowed in other countries. Why is that a way to get more votes, to spend money, to attack the next party? Today, you got to be proactive. You got to give solutions to get your vote, to get people to trust you. And to make matters even worse, they totally ignore global warming. And what do you do about that? They decide to take some taxpaying money and to give it to their friend in the Tarzan. Aren't you sick of that? The Tarzan, they make millions, one of the most profitable companies in the world, and we're giving our taxpaying money to that. Why is it in Europe they're 10 years ahead of us in terms of green technology? And we're one of the most advanced countries in the world. We have to change that. We need to vote green. We need to have a green economy based. We need to have a green economy based on green technology. And that could start by all of us starting to vote green. We're so lucky to have a leader like Elizabeth. She has so much energy. She inspires me. She inspires a million. We couldn't wish for any better person to be in the House of Commons for us. So all together, let's make sure this happens. Because with her voice, they won't be able to block us anymore. They're not going to be able to block us for any debates. And in that moment, we've all been waiting for it and stuff. So without any further delay, I present you our leader, That was a bad name.
Number of you will have to leave and get to that ferry, so I'm going to try to be, and those of you who know me well will know how difficult this is, I will try to be brief. I am so encouraged, and what we're seeing here tonight with the largest political rally that's happened in British Columbia in this campaign, we've done our best, we figure there's 800 of you in this room, which is pretty darn fantastic. This is our night, not to celebrate, but to re-energize each other, to recharge all of our rechargeable batteries full of non-toxic materials so that we can get out there between now and Monday, as Bill Deverell said at the beginning, to reach to anyone you know who's still stubbornly stubborn, to reach to those who are still not paying a lot of attention, to reach out to those who think, but I've never voted green before, what will happen? And to convince them that this time will not come again, that this moment in our political history, that this moment in our civilization where we stand on the precipice of either amazing transitional change to a bright and beautiful and secure, safe future for us and our children is that direction where we want to go, and on the other side is where the status quo wants to take us. Pedal to the metal to a climate crisis, ignoring the other issues that we should be talking about this election, the growing gap between the rich and the poor, or as Fraser talked about, why do we want to spend money on prisons when the crime rate's going down? There are a lot of issues over here that we know we want to avoid because we want to move here. And at that moment when humanity has a choice, and this is yes in Saanich Gulf Islands and yes in Canada, but it's also the whole world of us as the self-proclaimed smart ones, Homo sapiens, who now are a bigger force on the face of the earth than all natural forces, we have the opportunity to choose for ourselves survival, to choose for ourselves enlightenment, to choose for ourselves compassion, caring, to choose for ourselves empowerment to be the best we can be as humanity, and to choose to be conscientious, effective citizens and not mindless consumers. I've never seen an opportunity like this in my lifetime, and as you've heard from others, I've been active quite a long time, and I don't seem to burn out, and I seem to keep finding inspiration in things, but I've never been as inspired as I am standing right here with you now. The people who laid the groundwork for where we are now. Andrew Lewis, Green Party candidate over here. And Jane Stark, Green Party leader, Green Party of BC. Where are you, Jane? There you are. And people who run in other parties. Don Scott, former MLA, NDP, Manitoba. Yay, Don. We have a lot. We are, and I love this about Greens. Petra Kelly, with whom I was, actually Petra Kelly was dancing on the beach with me in Bella Abzug while we were singing it. Well, Leslie Gore was actually on stage. I mean, what kind of experience is this? Who has these experiences? Dancing barefoot in the sand with Bella Abzug and Petra Kelly while Leslie Gore sang, "It's my party and I'll cry if I want to." But Petra Kelly used to say that the German Green Party, which she founded, was the anti-party party. And that's why we're the home for everybody who's ever been in the Reform Party, the Conservative Party, the Liberal Party, the Democratic Party, or no party at all, and said there must be something better. We must be able to find a way to embrace what we have in common, to absolutely reject the politics of fear and division, the cynical manipulation of a populace which has been foisted on us by attack ad and political leader after political leader who do not deserve the term leader because they're so mediocre they drive us mad with boredom. For a breakthrough, and it's not a breakthrough for a party. It's a breakthrough for democracy. It's a breakthrough to re-engage and let Canadians know from coast to coast to coast that democracy works, that citizens have power, and that we can reclaim democracy in this country. And I am so grateful and honored, and I must say quite a few times tonight, blushing severely, I am so honored that you want me to be your voice. But when we win on Monday, it is we who win, not just me. It is all of us, not just the Green Party. This is a moment for citizen power. This is a moment for hope. This is a moment for our children and our little tiny babies in this room. We do this for your future, and we will work without ceasing until Monday, till every vote is counted, and Canadians wake up and say, thank you.